Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the Catering Cage, episode number 2. Today, I'm really excited. We have an incredible guest. Her name is Tracy Avolio. Tracy and I go way back, way back. We worked together at the Catering Institute. And I would say Tracy is probably one of the most incredible catering sales professionals that our industry has had the gift of receiving. And I'm so excited to have her on the show today. We're going to talk about catering sales, how to get them, how to maintain them, customer retention. We're going to have a great conversation about catering sales and how to have them on. So with no further ado, let me introduce you to Tracy Avolio. Tracy, welcome to the show.
Hi, Earl. It's so good to be with you. You know I always love an opportunity to talk catering with you.
Oh, Tracy, I'm so proud of you and what you guys are doing over at Byron at New Catering Connections. Can't wait to hear all about it. I was thinking back on our journey, you know, it's 2012. I mean, it's like, it's a long time, you know? So yes. I'm just so happy to see you. I miss you, to be honest. You know, stuff we did at the Catering Institute. I know, you're just outstanding. So look, tell us what's happening at New Catering Connections today. Let's see what's, you know, where have you evolved to?
It's been the most incredible journey, Earl. I mean, you know my passion for the catering space. I mean, I call myself a restaurant lifer. I've been in the industry for eons now. It's hard to believe it's 27 something years, but the last 20 years or so has been specifically in the catering space. And, you know, started my journey with Boston Market, doing regional and national sales for them for about a decade, working with you and the team, Earl, at the Catering Institute for another decade. Really focusing on helping multi-unit restaurants develop and grow their catering programs, focusing on that really strategic planning and then education. My partners and I, Byron and Abby and I, we launched New Catering Connections in January of 2023. I mean, it was a long-standing dream to do something like this, but I've just always had this passion deep down in my heart of supporting restaurants and filling what I've seen through all of these years as a very large gap and support that was desperately needed for the restaurants. And that was, how do we provide end-to-end sales for the restaurants and take the burden off of their shoulders and let them focus on what they do best, which is, you know, sort of the execution and the operations of the business, and provide them the sales. And so that is really how New Catering Connections was birthed. And we offer fractional catering sales support. So really any restaurant, franchisee, or enterprise brand can dip their toe into it at whatever level they feel comfortable with to have some of that ongoing, consistent catering support. And, you know, it was three of us in January. Supported our first 14 restaurants in February of last year. And now we're a team of 46 and growing, supporting about 600 restaurants, and it's an incredible journey.
Amazing, amazing. So you're getting results, obviously. You wouldn't be growing.
Yes.
Okay, can we break this down just a bit, Tracy, can we? Can we just kind of like talk about like what's happening here? Like, why is it? I mean, I think it's so interesting, you know, because, you know, we've worked together for so long and we've talked about, you know, that restaurants need to use elbow grease to get catering sales. Like, they're all looking for magic bullets, or, you know, like, you know, I mean, you know, there's marketplaces. We're going to talk about marketplaces in a bit. But, you know, I mean, you're doing the grunt work. You're doing the work that restaurants really don't want to do. Isn't that is that kind of what's happening? Right.
Right. Well, I mean, there's multiple facets. I mean, it's hard to have the resources to do it. The time to do it. It's always on the priority list, but other things always come into play. You know, a restaurant, every day something happens. And then if you've got somebody internally that you task with doing that position, then you have to coach them and manage them and provide them resources and tools. And it's, you know, it's a lot.
Let me ask you a question. You don't have to answer this, but I'm just curious. Are you able to, like, you know, you and I know, like, there's some brands out there who are investing heavily in direct catering sales, right? Like, we know, like, they're right. Are you working with those brands too? Or are they just like, are they protecting their salespeople and saying, no, we don't need New Catering Connections? Or are they doing their own thing? And also, you guys are coming in to help even more. Like, is that happening?
Right. Right. We're seeing all different scenarios. I mean, okay. We've got some that are just getting into the space now and have no idea what to do and need some help. Just, you know,
in those cases, they don't have catering salespeople.
Right. But there are also brands that we support that do have teams, but it may be that we're supporting their teams that have, you know, an enormous amount of restaurants that they're supporting. So it's hard for them to be able to tackle all of that. So we're supporting them.
Right.
Or there's the brands that have, you know, catering sales teams, but may not have them in specific markets, or it may not make sense to have a full-time person in those markets. So,
okay. So another way to say it is they could hire new catering connections to come in strategically to work in a very specific market if that market is soft on catering sales.
Absolutely.
And maybe they don't want to hire people. They just want to, or maybe they want to test a market.
Correct.
Right.
We're doing all of that. Yep, absolutely.
Interesting. I think it's such a fascinating ecosystem, you know, because, and I think this is the symphony, if you will. You know, if we were conducting like the ultimate, you know, catering sales experience, like what would we do? Okay. Well, we would recommend to the brand that they would invest in their own salespeople, of course, right?
Right.
You know, especially larger brands, like ones that have like, you know, 25, 30, 50, 100 units. Because, you know, we know that there's opportunities to build business relationships out there and sign large value contracts. We know that, right? So, so that's one thing. So they would partner with Easy Cater to be able to have their marketplace partner in some of those markets. And then they could also use you in the same situation. So the ecosystem could be, I've got my own salespeople, I've got Easy Cater in specific markets, I want to give it a lift in a particular area. And then I'm also using new catering connections to help me in that area as well. Is that a scenario?
Absolutely.
Amazing. Amazing. So you must be feeling pretty proud, Tracy.
I am. This is my new baby.
You deserve it.
In love with the work that we do and the team that we have. You know, everyone is just as passionate as Byron and I about this space. They love what they do, and
you know, I'd like to think you got some of that entrepreneurial spirit from our time together.
100%.
No, nice. You got it. You felt inspired.
You rubbed off on me, Earl.
Oh, that's very sweet. So let's dive in a little bit now into like, so you've got these catering sales professionals. You've got 46 of them.
Yep.
And they're all banging on doors and doing things. I would like to talk about the best practices. Like, what are these individuals doing? How are you training them? What are the behaviors that they're doing every single day that is driving these sales? And the reason why I think it's important to share is because sharing is caring, Tracy. And I think ultimately, like, if brands could tap into what you know and what you do, not only will they themselves potentially invest in some really good people, but in fact, they're also going to participate, you know, with new catering connections, Easy Cater, et cetera, et cetera. And I think it's a really important conversation to be having. So maybe you could share, you know, what is it that's so special? Like, what is it that you're doing? And I want to hear everything from like the culture all the way through to like the behaviors, like what is happening to get this business in the house.
The secret sauce of NCC.
Sure. If there is one.
Yep. Well, listen, I think we're all incredibly driven and passionate about the industry itself. And we love the restaurants and we love the catering space. We call our catering sales managers catering experts because we truly feel that is what they are, and they can support restaurants in far more than just having the sales conversations. They can strategize with them and talk about the business as a whole. But for us, you know, it really comes down initially to their personalities. You know, our team is built of several very tenured catering sales managers that have been with the big brands for a decade or more. And we also have another subset of the team that are seasoned professionals in other B2B industries. And they're some of our top performers because they're like, gosh, you know what? Talking about food is a glorious thing. It is so much easier and more fun than talking about what I was selling before. And so, you know, personality, you can't teach that. You know,
right.
our experts are very outgoing. They've never met a stranger. They can make connections. They are not afraid to ask questions and really to be inquisitive and to listen to what they're hearing and then provide solutions against what they're hearing. And for us, you know, we actually do love to share what we know and how we train and teach our catering experts. You know, we've got programs within New Catering Connections where we share that. And that's some of our offerings. And for us, we're very strategic, you know, because we are fractional catering sales support. So it's a handful of hours per week for different programs. We have to be very efficient and effective with that time. And so we are very, very focused on strategic targeting. All of our outreach is business to business. We know how that industry is surging beyond belief and all of the additional opportunities within the B2B catering space. So all of our outreach is to businesses, and we're very strategic. You know, we are looking at sort of we cherry pick those business industries that we know cater and do it with some frequency. We have an understanding of what their use cases are. And then we're also very calendar driven and really looking at every single month, what are the specific event opportunities? What are the industries that are attached to those? And we have a working backwards plan. You know, we're always reaching out 6 to 8 weeks ahead of opportunities. So we can get ahead of the opportunities, start to build some relationships, get top of mind, and really develop that. And so we call that VBR selling. You know, it's a valid business reason. So back in the day, you know, Byron and I always laugh. It's like, here's the yellow pages, go for it. and now, yes. Right now,
yellow pages. Oh my God.
Yeah.
Tracy, yellow pages.
Our audience won't even know what that is. Right? but so now it's not just calling and saying, hey, I'm Tracy with ABC. Do you guys cater? Can I send you a menu? It's, you know, hi, it's Tracy with ABC. I know that this event is coming up. Just wanted to see if you guys are celebrating that. Is there anything that we can do for you? And then start to engage in those conversations and really attaching and making it personal to those businesses so that it makes sense and then developing that relationship. And for us, it's about consistency.
Right.
You know, I'm old school. You have to touch people 7-8 times. Sales are not one time and there it happens.
Right. So on that note, Tracy, like just in turn, like that, so that's one of the behaviors, right? Which is how do you stay in touch? How do you stay in touch? So what kind of mediums are you using? Like a lot of companies I go into, like they just got, you know, the email marketing machines going and, you know, whatever. But you're actually using telephones.
Right. Our outreach, everybody works remotely across the U.S. So everything we do is phone, an email or text with our restaurant partners and the businesses. Yeah. I mean, we use a CRM that's also all of the two-way communication. So we buy local phone numbers to whatever restaurant we're supporting, so it looks and feels like we're local and a part of that team. We do the phone calls through that system. We do the emails through there, text messaging. So everything is stored.
Very cool.
The expert always has track of that. We can perform it through there.
So
all the data goes to customers.
So centralized numbers?
Yes.
Like through like virtual numbers?
Correct. Yeah.
Very cool. That's a great idea. I love it.
And we also, you know, you and I always talk about sampling as being one of the most impactful ways to sell catering. Get it in front of somebody.
For sure. Hey, question on these virtual numbers. Just a question for you.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know the answer, but can you get like the number 1-800-Tony's Catering or something? Like, can you do that?
I don't know the answer.
No, that's I like that idea. That's a good idea.
Right. Well, for the restaurants, we're just buying a local phone number. So
I understand, but when you're picking the phone number, I wonder if you could like get the letters to like, I don't know, it's something.
I could imagine that.
I think it'd be pretty cool. So virtual numbers, centralized answering, and then when your agents are your catering sales professionals who are doing the outbound work, right? They're tracking that in some CRM system, I would imagine. And then when the orders come in and they have to take the orders, like what are they doing? Are they doing them by hand? Are they taking them, like, are they putting them in some order management system? Like what's going on?
All of the above. very flexible. And it really is up to the restaurant partner and what tools they have and what they're most comfortable with.
Right.
Many will give us back-end access to their order entry tools.
Okay. So there, yeah.
So we can do that and then send the invoicing component directly to the customer. They pay online.
I like that.
You know, there are some that are not set up yet. You know, yeah. They're at the very early stages of this. So we have catering booking forms that we complete and send over to the restaurants, and then they rise and run with those orders.
Yeah, yeah. So here's a question for you, Tracy. This is a curious question. So, you know, you're out talking to these buyers, right? These admin assistants. And well, let's have the food at work conversation in a minute, but let's just still concentrate on catering for a second. But like the catering, you know, classic sort of old school catering idea, you know, drop off sandwiches, platters, salads, sandwiches. And so you're talking to these admin assistants, not you, but your team, and you know, you're accessing, you're trying to find out all the time who's the buyer, what's the budget. You're asking all these questions, right? Which is, you're gathering intel on these companies. You're storing them in a database. You're qualifying them, right, as you're prospecting.
Right.
And then you go into some sort of process, right? Which is like touch point 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yeah. 6. You know, now, and you might have a series of things you're doing in there, right?
Right.
It's like, it's not just one call and that's it. You're just like, right? You know? Like, what are the things? Like, so you're calling, you leave a message, you call again, you leave a message, you send an email, fine. You walk down there, you leave a sample, okay. You follow up again. Is that kind of the thing? Is that like what's happening?
It's very close, yes. We're old school. We believe in the seven touches rule, that you have to reach out at least seven times. And so we've got sort of a sequencing process in place. We always start with that initial phone call. And then if they're interested in more information, provide us their email address. We send them an email with information the restaurant wants us to share. Then we follow up, ensure they got that, see if they had any questions. And then there's a series of additional phone calls and emails. And we're following sort of that standard sales cycle window of 6 to 8 weeks and reaching out at least seven times. But we're also very cognizant of each time we reach out that it's not simply calling and asking for a catering order.
Yeah.
That we're always calling with something of value, you know, some new information that we haven't shared before. Introducing something new, an LTO, or here's how easy it is to order. Just, you know what, I was thinking about you today. I saw this new event that's coming up and I thought of you. So those constant touches. And then because we're only virtual, you know, we also work very closely with the restaurants and we'll warm up leads that we feel have great potential.
Right.
It would be great opportunities for then the restaurant staff to go by, introduce themselves and drop off those samples and really sort of the edge.
Right. So like on any given day, like today, you got 46 people that are out pounding the pavement.
Right.
How many phone calls will get generated today?
We're generally seeing that our experts are reaching about 30 businesses over a 3 hour period of time.
Okay. So wait a minute. Can we do some math there just for a minute?
Sure.
So 30 times 46.
It's a lot.
Like, what is that? Like, so if it was 40 times 30 would be 1,200. So, you know, it's like over 1,200. So 1,200 touch points. What's that?
Yes. 1,380.
1,300 touch points today.
In 3 hours.
In 3 hours. Okay. And is that something we do every day?
Yes, we run our calling windows. We pick the prime windows, so we do from 9 to 12 and 1 to 4.
Okay, so five days a week you're doing that? That's like one session 5 days a week, or how's it?
We don't do outreach calls on Mondays.
Okay.
We don't find them to be as effective. So
people are busy.
Most heavily Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday morning.
For four sessions a week, pretty much, right? So
each expert can support up to 10 different programs or 10 different locations throughout the month. So,
okay. So 4 times a week, 1300 touch points every time. So, you know, I'm losing track. There's 6,000 touch points, more or less. That's just the phone work.
Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That doesn't include emails. Right.
Wow. And putting together of quotes and placing orders and And it's nice to see too, because within our CRM, we can also track the number of engagements that an expert has with any given individual. And there's sometimes where they're talking to somebody at the business 30 times before an order gets placed.
But so you're getting results, Tracy, which is really cool. And I tell you, you know, it's so interesting. And I'm going to quote my father. Well, I'll change the word a little bit, but my father used to say, you know, the more stuff you throw against the wall, the more sticks, right?
Right.
So I changed the word stuff, but I mean, I think he gets it. So, okay. So just in summary, like, let's just agree then. Okay. Can we agree that, old school selling still works?
100%.
Okay. See, that is probably the most exciting thing that's going to happen on this season's podcast. Okay. Because every brand I go into, not every, many brands I go into, most do not appreciate what direct business to business selling is. They don't understand the investment. They don't understand the return. They don't understand how long it takes. They just don't understand, like, you know, why am I not getting results? And like, there's just this whole thing, you know, like it's they just don't get it, you know? So it's really, really exciting that, you know, you're able to sit there with all of your experience and years and years and years of experience to tell this community, our community, that old school selling still works.
Right.
Okay. So then why aren't more of us doing it is the question.
And there's a place for all of the other tactics and components as well, for sure. But for me, like, you know, the other avenues, digital and marketplaces and things like that, those are amazing tools to have. You get visibility and in front of people that you may never have the opportunity to do. So you can get introduced to your, you know, you can introduce businesses to your brand and your restaurants, multiple different channels. But for me, my thinking is, you know, truly the long-term lifetime loyal customer is going to be dependent upon their experience with you, their trust in you, and the end result with that event with you at the restaurant.
Okay. So, I mean, look, people want to buy from people they like.
Right. 100%.
Right. And people, and we know in the catering transaction, these are high risk transactions. So they got to trust you. Like they want to know that if it all goes wrong, that you're going to be there to fix it. Right.
Right.
And I imagine you guys get involved in that too, right? You guys get involved, you troubleshoot the orders, you do all that stuff. Right.
Absolutely.
So it's more than just catering sales. It's catering sales and catering sales management.
To an extent. Yes.
Yeah. Right. I mean,
voice for a lot of these restaurants and who the business knows.
Yeah.
That live person that they know to go to. So
question
absolutely.
For you. Question, because every day is like a game for you guys, right? Like you got all these orders, you got like 46 people cranking up new business. You got all these orders coming in, you got order changes happening. You got mistakes taking place. You got all these restaurant suppliers on the other side. You guys are having to deal with this mayhem all day, you know, every day. I imagine the mornings are crazy, but you know, I guess, right? The mornings are nuts for you guys probably, but,
it's wonderful. I guess,
Yeah. And so here's my question for you. And this is more related to you. Okay. Because are you more like of a coach now to your salespeople, or are you doing direct sales too now? Like, where are you now?
We're supporting and coaching, the catering experts, and it's really been beautiful to see. I mean, obviously we're a year and a half old. We're youngins still in this space.
But I'm talking about you, Tracy. Like, what are you playing the coaching role inside there now? Training your salespeople?
All of us, you know, at the executive level are part of the coaching and the development and the mentorship. And then we have tenured experts that have been with us since the beginning. Now also moving into those roles and helping the newer ones come up and really helping them think strategically about sales and understanding use cases and how to connect the dots. And so we've really got a nice chain of support and mentorship.
What about controls? Like, what about like, how many calls you're making? What's converting? What's like, are you tracking all that data?
Well, yes and no. we're tracking everything that our experts are doing, and we're monitoring, and we're, you know, holding them accountable to sort of our standards on outreach and those components that we can track. With what we're doing, we're able to track the orders that we know come in or that we have visibility into. I mean, that's the only thing, is we don't have 100% visibility into everything.
Right, right.
When we're sharing and selling catering, you know, we're not only giving them the option to place orders with us. You know, we're sharing the direct online ordering links to their website.
Right.
We're sharing phone numbers to the restaurant. So, you know, these business buyers, they're savvy. They'll order themselves online. So we may not have visibility into that.
Gotcha.
But there are brands that we work very close with, that we've done some large scale programs with, where they're helping us track. So we're getting a good visual of the ROI on the programs and how they're progressing.
Great. So one question before we move on to this article, Tracy, that I want to talk about with you a little bit. But so what's the biggest catering order you've taken?
Oh, gosh. You should have asked me that before. It was about, I think it was about $5,000 or $6,000.
Okay.
And we've had multiples of those. And that was just for one single order. And we've had multiples of those.
You haven't seen any like 25, 30, 100 yet?
Not yet. But watch, as soon as we get off this podcast.
I'm wishing one on you.
Thank you.
I'm going to call and place an order for that.
No, perfect.
But then I'm going to cancel it. So there's an article that we have been talking about a little bit. And I think the article is called Return to Office Traffic is Fueling a Catering Boom in 2024. And it's all about Cracker Barrel, BJ's, Wings and Rings, and really like what's going on, you know, specifically in the space. And I'd love to talk a little bit about this with you. Did you get a chance to read the article, $124 billion, you know, industry that seems to be bouncing back post-pandemic in a way that it didn't before?
Absolutely.
I'd love for you to share some insights on that.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know that any of us would have projected the way that catering is surging post-pandemic. Yeah. I mean, what last year it was 73 billion, and then by 2032 projected at 124 billion. I mean, and just the B2B space, just the use cases for catering have expanded so greatly. You know, obviously food now is being utilized as incentives to bring people into the office. They're using it as benefits and perks when they're interviewing new employees. It's being used as a retention tool. And, you know, I've seen other statistics where, you know, meals for employees it's now surpassing the buying for client, you know, internal meetings and training sessions and things like that. And that's just continuing to grow. And business buyers are planning on spending exponentially more this year than last year. And that's just going to continue to grow. You know, that's not going anywhere. And employees really love that perk. You know, food is so powerful. It's amazing. You know, it brings such joy to people. People value food and just the ability to sit around their colleagues and friends and break bread and have a meal. And it just impacts so many different parts of people's worlds and lives. And that's just going to continue to grow.
Yeah, it's interesting. I was talking with, I think it was with Paul Barron on a previous episode. We were talking about the young generation that are beginning to pull back on like consumer spending. Like, you know, we're seeing it in fast food, fast casual, losing some steam a little bit. And, you know, because there's a lot of, you know, financial pressures and all that kind of stuff that's happening. And we talked about actually Dilip over at ShareBite. I don't know if you know Dilip or not, but brilliant guy. And he was pointing out that in decades, the mid-century, you know, mid-1900s, that companies fed their employees, you know? So you came to work, you had breakfast, you had your coffee, your break, you had lunch, you had an afternoon snack, and then you went home and you worried about dinner, you know, and that was what it was. And that wasn't in part of the, that was part of the culture, and it was the part of the American culture, you know, it was back. And so he cited a whole bunch of cases, and so I wonder if we're coming back into a time, you know, where companies are going to you know, take more responsibility for feeding their employees to keep them fueled and healthy and coming into the office, you know, like whatever they need to do to just keep them incentivized to keep producing. And that's a massive conversation to be had and super interesting. And is actually the thesis, Tracy, for like what is the entire impetus for the restaurant catering workshop coming up in Denver. And you're going to be part of that, right?
I am. Can't wait.
What are you going to talk about?
Catering sales, of course.
Yes, you are. Yeah, Tracy's going to be there. I think you're on a panel with, I've lost track now. I think Gracie is on there from Jason's Deli. We've got Alan Beck from Costa Vida. I think I've lost track on who else is on that panel. But we got an amazing roster of speakers. And we're going to get into the details even deeper than we did today because we're running out of time and we only have this short opportunity to do this today. But, why would you encourage operators to come to this workshop? Like, why should they come and take time out and get on airplanes and, you know, book hotels and all that kind of stuff?
I mean, if you look at the roster of people that are participating in the workshop, I mean, those are leaders that have had success beyond recognition. I mean, there is so much wealth of knowledge that's going to be in that room. And it really covers all components of the business. It's just not sales, certainly. It's operations, it's technology, it's sales, it's marketing, it's delivery. It's every component of the business. And again, we all love to share the knowledge and learnings that we've accumulated over the years. Plus, these events are just one of the most wonderful ways to have a sense of community. And every time I've ever been to any kind of conference or workshop or event, you learn so much from your fellow attendees as well. You learn if there are some similar struggles or some similar successes. And you may find yourself a mentor or a mentee at these events as well. There's just, it's a wealth of knowledge. And I think everyone that's included, all of these speakers, they're really passionate about the industry and really wanting to support and rise everyone else up so that they can see the same level of success.
Amazing, Tracy. Well, listen, I got two more questions for you before I let you go, but I just wanted to say thank you for supporting the workshop and thank you for supporting this podcast. Congratulations on all your success. I'm so happy for you. I'm so proud of you. I was just such an honor to work with you for so many years and the amazing work we did together. So I'm grateful for that. I'm really looking forward to seeing you in October.
Thank you for leading the way for me, Earl.
Yeah. You
empowered me and helped me grow my confidence and gave me a stage to grow and blossom. And I'm forever grateful.
That's amazing. Well, I really appreciate that opportunity. And so here's one question I want to ask you. When you go into a brand and you start talking to them, what is the one red flag that you see for catering that makes you walk away from doing business with them?
Ooh, one red flag. Well, there's a few.
Okay, well, let's talk about what are the few?
Well, I think it's important that the brand, listen, all the brands have catering as a priority, right? It's always a priority. They always want it to be, and even now more so than ever, a significant part of their revenue source. But a lot of the brands are missing leadership and somebody that really owns the catering business. I mean, for us, it's always, you know, catering is just not an add-on to what you're already doing today. It's a business unto itself, and it has to be developed as such. And so it needs a leader, somebody that's going to eat, sleep, dream it, and manage it and champion for it. And without that, there's a lot of struggles, a lot of roadblocks, and it's hard to really gain traction.
Yep.
That's one piece. You know, having resources against catering. You can't just put up a sign and say, we cater and off you go. You can't just print a menu and off you go. There's so many components that have to be in place in order for that catering program to be successful. I mean, we could go out and sell it all day long, but if the rest of the business can't support it and follow behind it, it's difficult.
So operations is key. And look, Tracy, where did you get that from?
That looks familiar. I see a familiar monkey face there.
Yeah. Well, there you have it, gang. You've heard it from none other than Tracy Avolio, probably one of the best, not just in terms of her skills as a catering sales professional, but just an all-around amazing human being. And we're just lucky that she's here on the show. And Tracy, thanks for coming in. Talk to you again soon. Thanks. There you have it, folks. Another episode of The Catering Cage. Tune in next week when we have another really exciting guest.